Welcome back, everybody, to the Assert, Defend, Take Space Aboriginal Youth Conference on Identity, Activism, and Film. For those of you just joining us, I would like to acknowledge that the museum is on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Hunkaminam-speaking Musqueam people. As uninvited guests on this territory, it is the museum's protocol to acknowledge that the work that we do here cannot be done without the Musqueam people. And just a quick recap, this conference is a companion to the exhibition Claiming Space, Voices of Urban Aboriginal Youth, and it is important to take the time to listen to both the creative works of young Aboriginal peoples and their ideas. It is also a testament to the many achievements and the potential that Aboriginal youth have today. Just to go over what the next two sessions will be, the next one is called The Gaze. It will run from 1 to 2:30, and then we will have a quick 15-minute coffee break. And then the third session will be called Real Medicine from 2:45 to 4:30. This next session, The Gaze, Deconstructing the Objectification of Indigenous Women. The moderator of this session will be Celia Joseph. Celia is Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh, and European descent. She is a First Nations Studies major whose research focuses on Indigenous women and Indigenous feminisms. She has participated in the 2014 F-Word Conference presenting on Indigenous feminisms and is currently creating a podcast which features the work of Indigenous women on campus. So just a reminder that this session will end at 2:30. So I'd like to invite Celia up, please. Thank you. Gayla Kesla. Hello. Let me just get my notepad up and ready. Bear with me. All right. Celia Joseph, Queen Sna, Tanachin Shla, Tkohumish, Ohumeo, Aluin, Aksuin, Isqualuin, E. Odin, Sequeto, E. Haichkat, Masquiam. My name is Celia Joseph, and I'm on my father's side from the Squamish Nation as well as the Tsleil-Waututh people on Vancouver Island in Nanaimo. On my mother's side, I'm of Jewish and English descent. So, in my welcoming, I just acknowledged who I am, thanked you all for being here, and acknowledged, most importantly, where I am. So, just as Rebecca has put eloquently, I want to acknowledge again that we are on the Musqueam territory, and put my hands up for them for hosting us. And yeah, we're forever grateful, and we have to be always considering what it means to be here and what our jobs are as guests on this territory. I'd also like to start by acknowledging the work of Pam Brown and Elmaya Tailfeathers in curating and co-curating the Claiming Spaces exhibit, which brought us all here today. I think it's an incredible exhibit that has made a really important intervention into the space of a museum and also onto this campus. Brought a lot of questions and brought some of the most important voices together. So I'm really happy to be here today. As Rebecca said, a lot of my work focuses on Indigenous women and feminisms, in part inspired by the women that I come from in my family and lots of the scholars that we come across, and of course Dori Nason sitting in the audience. So I would like to just go through and give a brief introduction to the wonderful panelists that we are going to be discussing these films with today. I'd also want to acknowledge that the last panel was set up a little bit different, as most of the creators of the films themselves were the panelists, whereas on this panel we just have one of the filmmakers. So it'll be a little bit of a different dynamic, given the full title of this panel, The Gaze, Deconstructing the Objectification of Indigenous Women. The purpose, I think, is that, and having talked to the panelists, is that we brought different artists and speakers together whose research and work all focuses on this theme and on Indigenous women and sovereignty and representation. So part of the conversation is to look at these films, talk about the medium of film, and also just how our work might be related to each other. So I think one of the themes of this panel could be intersectionality in that way, thinking of how all of our work is related. And yeah, so that'll kind of be the general structure of this panel. So first, we have Elena Neal. So Elena is a multimedia artist who explores materials, text, and identity. She has a piece in the Claiming Spaces exhibit that looks at the representation of Indigenous women. I don't know if who's been to the Claiming Spaces exhibit. Good. That's important. So she had the photography piece that had different derogatory representations and words of Native women and Native people written on her body, and I'd really like if she could tell us a bit more about that piece afterwards, because I think it's a really important piece. She is studying family and community counseling at the Native Education College. So that's a little bit about Ellen and Neil. And I'll also give all of our panelists an opportunity to introduce themselves and tell you where they come from. It's better said in their words, I think. Kelly Clifton graduated with a BFA from UVic. She's currently attending the Frida Deesing School in Terrace, and it's a carving school. And she showed me a little bit of her work before we started today, and I was blown away. She's super, super talented. And she is also one of the artists from the exhibit, and she has the canvas called The Male Gaze. And for those of you who were in the exhibit, I think you can attest to the power of that piece. And again, I'd love her to talk about that a little bit. And then we have Andrea Landry. She has a master's in communications and social justice. And she's teaching Native studies at the University of Saskatchewan. She's presented at the World Conference of Indigenous Women in Lima, Peru. And she, her research focuses on issues of colonial versus indigenous ideologies regarding sovereignty and nationhood. So she'll bring a lot to this conversation from that perspective. And then our last panelist is Janine Frey Najutli. Sorry if I didn't get that. If I didn't get that right. I wrote it down phonetically. Pardon? All right. So Janine is currently doing a Master's of Fine Arts at UBC. So she's a new student here, which is exciting. I've seen her work before, and so I was really happy that we're going to be sharing space here and getting to know each other. She did an undergrad at Emily Carr and is interested in politics of representation and the potential for a decolonial aesthetic future. I like that. So let me just give you a really brief discussion of the films that we're going to be watching. It's going to be really brief because the filmmakers aren't here. And so I'd really like to let the films speak for themselves. First, we have a film called Traditional Me by Jamie Blackenship. Then we have Who I Am, Life Project Auckland. Then have Untitled by Janine. And Tashina by Carolyn Manette. So I talked to Janine. This is the one that I will talk about, is her film, because she's here and she'll be able to talk about it in the flesh. But I saw her piece and I heard Almaya Tail Feathers describe it. And then this morning I got to sit with her for a little brief kind of exploration of what it was to her. And so in her words, she says that part of this piece and her other piece, the cloak in the museum, talk about present-day ideas of traditions and the fetishization of Indigenous women and the performativity of race and gender. She talked to me quite a bit about the intention behind the set and what people were wearing, and of course it's art and everything's intentional, and so I want you to be thinking about where she might have been coming from. And then we can compare where she was coming from with what you got from it, and I think that's probably going to be interesting for you to see what people get from it. She covers her face. I think that something that I will mention that stuck with me when she was describing the film was just how, really plainly, how Indigenous women have been like sexualized and represented in the mainstream media, and how this film looks to take control of ways that but that's happened traditionally. And she, the character in this film, looks to represent herself and looks to take control of her own image, her own indigeneity, and her own sexuality. So, without further ado, let's watch these films.
As I walk through the streets with my moccasins, as I pass each person with my shawl gently on my shoulders, as I cross the street with the traditional me, as everyone stops to stare at the Indian girl standing on the sidewalk, as I stand there with nothing but pride and confidence, as I stand there alone representing all my people, I smile. As I stand there alone, representing all my people, I smile and laugh as I walk through the streets with my moccasins.
Nanungu wano koviti na wunundu mona taundua. My home, my Fiji, the place I cherish the most. Multicultures woven from coast to coast, consisting approximately of about 300 small isles, brown skin, bushy hair, pearly white smiles. This is my culture, my identity, who I am. I wish I were there right now. Damn. But here I am in the land of the long white cloud, trying my best to become one with the Kiwi crowd. And so began the change to fit in, changes that led to the disappearance of my natural Afro curls, contrasted well on my dark chocolate skin. And as much as I love Michael Jackson, may he rest in peace, I use no such skin lightening bleach. And as for my hair, yes, there were chemicals involved, but also my knowledge of my tradition and culture has evolved. From a respectable perspective of a cultured PI to a perspective of I have rights kind of PI. This is where opinions begin to clash. I start to think deeply, slowly twirling my invisible mustache. Follow the tradition of my elders passed on from generation to generation. Or realize my rights as a human and fight with such frustration. But to be honest, I don't think I want to fit in. Because if it means throwing away my respect for my culture and my elders, then it would be the worst of my failures. Failures to keep my culture and its tradition tattooed in my mind and in my heart. For it was my culture and its tradition that modeled me into who I am today, like fine art. And as I deliver this poem to you, I hope with all my heart that I have made a breakthrough. I hope you realize the good of keeping one's culture alive, because without it, you and your ancestors wouldn't have learned how to survive. This is your culture, your identity, who you are. Your land, your home, the place you cherish the most.
A tiny house. It's cramped, but it's cozy. I miss the security and the safety. The schooling is really behind city curriculum. My mom didn't want that for me, so I came to Winnipeg. I haven't been home in a year. The distance from my family was the hardest thing to deal with.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, Grandpa?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, where's Coco?
She's calling herself. She went to St. Therese. I'm coming here. What's wrong with your phone? Nothing's wrong with our phone.
No, hello?
In the reserve, everybody knows everybody. Here, I'm just a different face in the crowd. It took me a while to get used to it, but I'm doing it. things coming at me from everywhere now. I hope I can maintain who I am and what I'm trying to do. Family, a lot of things they don't have now. Kids are hungry. It's not pretty. I want to change that. Nobody holds me by the hand. I want to take this as far as I can take it.
I'd like to call up our panelists, please.
Hey, well, that was great. That was now my second time looking at all those films. And it's a different experience watching them at home versus having talked to these women and thinking about the theme of this panel, but then also having had the chance to listen and see the work of the filmmakers that came before on panel number one. I think this is a really cool and inspiring atmosphere to be looking at these things and thinking about how they affect us and how we affect each other. So now, as I'd mentioned before, I'd just like to go through and have our panelists introduce themselves. Anything I missed or anything you'd like to say about yourself would be a good time.
I guess I'll start on this end, if that's all right. My name is Andrea Landry. My traditional name is Migizio Dekwe. I come from the traditional territory of Paysquat. It's in northwestern Ontario, about 2.5 hours east of Thunder Bay. But now I reside on Palmaker in Treaty 6 in Saskatchewan. As she said, I did complete my master's in communications and social justice. And a lot of my research focused on how CBC and mainstream media portrays the Indigenous struggle. So I focused primarily on the 1969 White Paper discussions, the 1990 Oka crisis, and the Edelman-Moore movement. And I really looked at how mainstream media sets these ideologies, these colonial ideologies, and perpetuates it into mainstream society. I'm also involved with the United Nations. I'm the North American representative for the Global Indigenous Youth Caucus, and I participate in a variety of international meetings where we discuss how to overcome colonial oppression. I guess I'll get more into that as the conversation continues. So that's me, Miigwech. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Chinookanajutli. I'm from the Ventuk-Wichin First Nation on my dad's side from Ulker, Yukon, and also have Czech and Dutch ancestry. And I just started my master's program at UBC here, and when Rose Ann Stefan was talking in the last panel about putting herself through this Oh, okay. when Rose was talking about putting herself through this theoretical boot camp, I guess, I was just like, yeah, I get you. So, my practice is evolving and shifting, and I'm really excited about that. And, like, this exhibition for me is happening at a really pivotal point for myself and my development as an artist, and I'm really honored to be here with you all. Merci, Cho.
I am El Nanio. I am of a Hauset of New Channels Nation, and I am Kwagils of the Kwakwaka'wakw Nation. I am currently studying at Native Education College for the Family and Community Counseling course. I'm not sure exactly where I'm going to go with that, but again, I am 22, so I got a lot of time to figure that out. other than that, I'm very happy to be here, and I'm actually very happy to be here at such a young age at the MOA. It's so exciting. And thanks you guys all for coming.
Hello, everybody. My name is Kelly Clifton. My family is Gitgat from the community of Hartley Bay, and I grew up in Prince Rupert. I graduated from the University of Victoria in 2011 with my Bachelor of Fine Arts, and then I continued to stay in Victoria, where I worked with the British Columbia Arts Council as well as the First Peoples Cultural Council. That was through the Aboriginal Youth Internship Program, which I see some familiar faces in the audience from the program. And from there, I moved back up north to Terrace, British Columbia, where I'm currently learning how to carve at the Frida Deasing School. I'm extremely excited to be here and see so many familiar faces. It feels really good to come to the big city, and it means a lot to me to see so many people here. So thank you.
Thank you, ladies. I couldn't help but think when I was gathering any last thoughts from you about what you might want me to put in your introduction, how honored I am to sit on a panel with these diverse women who are all doing really important and inspiring things. So I'm really excited to be here. Given we have one of the filmmakers, I think because the film is fresh in our mind, it would be nice for us just to start there. I don't know, Janine, if you want to start by talking about it a little, or if you'd just like me to open it up to questions. It's your call. Would you like to go first?
I could talk about it a little.
Cool.
So that piece I made I finished editing it just in 2014, but I shot it in 2013 at a residency at the Banff Center that was facilitated by Dwayne Linklater, who's lead faculty. And that was a really great opportunity, too. And, I was thinking a lot about the adoption of Western materials into Indigenous culture, but it's not an adoption. Like, that puts it into a binary, and it's more like this interesting site of mixing. And I think the first time that I read about or started thinking about that site of mixing was with some writing that David Garneau had done on decolonial aesthetics. And so this piece for me was looking at these different sites of mixing and also drawing attention to the representation of Indigenous women and how our bodies, how ourselves and identities are perceived and in turn a lot of times are also objectified. And those are some of the themes that I was working through with that piece.
Are there any questions in the audience about this film or her process?
Yeah. I was really struck by the lack of sound in the film, and I wanted to ask you about that, why you didn't include sound.
I think a lot of times in my work, I give the viewer too much information, and I think that there's something important about access and denial, and that's becoming more and more prevalent in my work. And also this act of cutting or of choosing, like what is it that you choose to withhold, and what is it that you choose to give? Because you in making work that you choose to share with other people, you are giving like a part of
yourself, or I feel like that anyway, which is why I like... Yeah, so that's one of my choices around sound. And then more recently, I have been working on specifically sound-based projects and just thinking about how powerful of a medium sound can be, but also having a large presence in an absence.
Are there any more questions in the audience?
Yeah, over there.
There is a lot of sounds coming from a lot of different areas, different types of media. How do you feel about that interaction with your piece, since you made the decision to have it be silent and they are getting all those different kind of soundscapes? How do you feel about that interaction, that relationship with your piece, how do you view your pieces? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you for those questions. I think it's great. I really love how the sound like bleeds in and out of each other in the space there, and it kind of creates its own cacophony of sounds. And that's also something that I noticed was a strategy in the Beat Nation exhibit, how sound carries from room to room. And as you spend time with pieces in that exhibit, the sounds carry with you. And you kind of, they become like a residue in your memory as you experience the next piece and the next piece. And maybe the sounds are just, I mean, they're different perspectives too. And I feel that they, if anything, like they, I enjoy the interaction that they have with the work.
Any more? Oh yeah, over in the back.
I was struck by the pouring of the water in the very end scene, and I was curious to know how that as an element gave significance to the meaning of the overall piece.
What did you get from it?
It's sort of a life giver process, water, and how we use it. And I was also curious about the instrument that was used to pour it out. To me, it looked like kind of a head piece or some kind of part from that. So the way they interact with the materials and the materiality of what you are saying, I think that's just really drew me into the overall meaning.
Thank you. I don't think I'm going to disclose all my materials today. but yeah, with the water, I get to use one of my new MFA words here. I was also thinking about like religiosity and ritual and also myth making and construction and deconstruction of culture. And with the water, I mean, it's just, I wanted to have it present in the work. And I think sometimes works, they reveal themselves to you slowly over time. And like, even though this work, someone could call it static, but they always, like all the works, like even the works in this, oh, I won't say that, but I think with artworks, once they're created, even if if they're an object, a video work, a sound piece, and even if they never shift themselves in their first iteration, they will always continue to change in relation to what they're displayed beside, but also what's happening in history and in the cultures that are surrounding that work. And I'm going on a tangent. Thank you.
Are there any more questions in the audience before we move on? Yes.
Kind of, again, building off the last comment, was my the connotation I got from the water was actually quite different.
Okay, is that doing anything? Nothing? No. A little bit? Oh.
Thought of waterboarding and the different images that we get of, you know, women being tortured and that kind of thing. So it was like a really harsh, intense image, but it also does have that same connotation that was previously being discussed as like being this kind of cleansing and like really kind of spiritual material. Was there any of that in kind of when you're coming up with a piece?
I think that these two different readings are really important, and that it's, I'm happy that my work can, I don't know, bring that forward to some, to different people. And there's definitely, like, there's some, like, there's some intense, well, yeah, I'm thinking about objectification of Indigenous women. It's not light, you know, so I'm not surprised to hear that some of those things are also called to mind when watching the film.
All right. Well, I want to thank you, Janine, because not only is it brave to show your work, because it's something that's incredibly intimate and personal, and there's a lot more to this story than you want to share or that people could gather right now. You could talk about it for a long time. So thank you for sharing it, and also thank you for talking and being put on the spot right in the beginning of this panel.
Good, you got to jump right in, right?
Yeah, get on in there. But I think something that's really nice about the setup of a panel is that you're not sitting alone. You're sitting beside these other women who are supporting you and supporting each other through the work that they do. So that's the nature of this panel, is the diversity in our involvement in our communities, and how we can create dialogue together. So I'd like for us to talk about the films, like just like we're kind of hanging out and talking about how our own work is a part of this work and how this work is a part of our own work. So maybe the first question that I'll ask to the other panelists, given we have Janine here and we're starting with her film, is how the expression and the message in her work might be related to the expression and in your own work, and how your work, even though they're different mediums, whether it's through university teaching or carving or performance art, how they speak to each other. So you can take your time to think about whatever you might want to say there.
Maybe I'll jump in. For me, the one thing that I think is incredible about all of the films in relation to one another and also in relation to many of the pieces in Claiming Space is that they are being told from the female perspective, from that artist's perspective. So I think that's really powerful. When all of the Claiming Space artists met one another for our media day that we had before the opening, it was pretty powerful to see that the majority of the artists were female. So that in itself is very exciting, and that's kind of what the first thing that really strikes me within the films and even just having us here is that it's coming from that strong female point of view. All the stories are very different, but nobody else is telling that story. It's coming from that person, which is nice.
I also wanted to focus on all four of the films as a whole as well. I think one of the underlying themes that we are focusing on within these is the concept of Indigenous rage. Indigenous rage has been, you know, intrinsically within our DNA for generations. It's through the discourse of oppression, through the discourse of colonization, through forced assimilation processes, and now we're seeing it as underlying currents within, whether it's pieces of art, whether it's documentaries, whether it's our everyday life, you know, and this so-called form of Indigenous rage has become a beautiful thing. Because when we think of rage, we think of anger, we think of emotions that we aren't used to expressing. And we become ashamed of this rage. We become ashamed of how we're going to express this rage, how we're going to express, you know, generations of oppression. And what has made it unsafe for us to really express this? And again, it's the colonial discourse that's coming in and it's trying to break down our barriers and it's trying to, you know, set up walls against us on what's important to express. So one thing I really noticed within these films, within these documentaries, is that rage is being expressed in such a beautiful way. And I think that we as Indigenous people should never be ashamed of that rage. I think we have to, you know, showcase it and express it in these fundamental ways that are really generating community dialogues. So that's one of the key things I noticed within these films, and I think that this kind of work definitely has to continue.
Building off that kind of rage that you're talking about, there's also a theme of identity and rage of finding your identity as a young person and as an Aboriginal person in an urban space. Maybe you've come from far away, maybe you grew up here, maybe you were disconnected. And that rage of... and that rage of not knowing who you are and having to discover who you are because you weren't given the privilege of getting to know who you were growing up. And with that, there's also, what does it mean to be an Indigenous woman? What is it to be an Indigenous woman in an urban space? And what is it to be a little girl growing up as an Indigenous person? That's all. So the first film that we watched, Traditional Me, I was wondering if we could go through and you could give me some of your thoughts on what the filmmaker was trying to do and how it spoke to you.
I feel like it was a, you know, it's a powerful juxtaposition, right? Like she's... she was choosing to do her traditional dances in these urban settings, and I think that that as a site to it's like a site of it's a protest. I think that her dancing is a really beautiful and powerful act of dissent in that space, and just showing that it is something that's, you know, to be proud of and that it's thriving and doing well, but that it's also like shifting, but it's also demanding people to look at it and like pay attention to her, and like she has a voice, and maybe she's not doing this, but she's doing, she's showing her voice in the way that in the ways that she knows.
Yeah, and I kind of will go off of that. When I saw it and when I was, you know, kind of gathering my thoughts afterwards, it really speaks to the concept where young Indigenous peoples in the urban settings, you know, they are struggling. And a lot of it has to do with, well, who am I? A lot of it has to do with, where do I come from? A lot of it has to do with, you know, how do I represent myself in a setting that doesn't even want me to allow myself to represent myself? You know, how am I going to make myself known and be feel proud of who I am in a space that wants me dead? You know, and that's the reality that a lot of young and, you know, older Indigenous peoples are feeling in these urban settings, in these spaces. So I think what that film and that documentary really spoke to was expressing that, you know, expressing that, why must we feel shame for expressing ourselves as Indigenous peoples in spaces that don't want us there? You know, and really overcoming the barriers and the obstacles that are instilled within, you know, cities. When I was doing my master's, I almost quit a million times because the reality was, you know, what would I rather be doing, learning my language back home or studying in a colonial setting that has no space for my concepts or ideologies or reality? And this documentary really showcased that, you know, we shouldn't feel shame. We shouldn't feel like we have to back down in these urban spaces. You know what? And this land and this territory has become so colonized that settler society feels that they have the right to say we're allowed to be in certain spaces. And they may not say it to our faces today, but that is a lot of the dialogue that's occurring. So I think that this film definitely showcase a lot of the underlying issues that Indigenous peoples are facing in the urban setting, and I think they did it in a very, very beautiful way.
What I took away from the first film was the idea of breaking down stereotypes. It was really nice to see a young, strong, proud First Nations woman dancing in her traditional regalia out in the open and showing it off to the world with such pride. That's what I found really moving. So, I don't know, it's nice. I mean, when I think of Elena's piece there with all of those words across her body, such as Pocahontas or whatnot. It's just kind of nice to see a young woman who's truly showing the world who we are. And we're all from different nations, all have different stories, but it really came across to me that she was proud of where she comes from.
Thank you for sharing. In a lot of your responses, you talked about what it means to be urban, and how that might influence you, and whether or not you grew up in your community or you grew up in the city or wherever, you're all here today. And a line in that film, she says, "Here I am, standing there alone, representing all my people." So in a way, as she goes forth and claims her own space, that's what you've done in your lives and in your exhibit and on this stage. So how does that line resonate with you and the work that you do? So here I am standing there alone representing all my people. What did that line in the film mean to you?
For me, actually in this film as well as Tashina, the last one, there were some very powerful moments that I related to. When I was growing up, I grew up in Prince Rupert, and my dad came from Hartley Bay, which is a reserve of about 100 people or a village. And so technically, I guess that is one way of being urban, right? I'm in a larger community. However, Prince Rupert is tiny compared to Victoria, where I ended up. So I remember my first year of UVic, so many questions coming my way, and so many mixed emotions. Like, I was in an all-girls dormitory, the only First Nations person there, and the girls would be like, "Oh, this is Kelly, she's Native, she gets to go to school for free." That's like all they'd say. And so facing experiences like that, clearly, and then in the visual arts program, I was, I believe, one of 4 or 5 First Nations students in the entire program. So being that one person representing your whole nation, that's a very challenging job. And oftentimes in those settings, you're expected to not only represent your specific nation, but all First Nations people. That, which isn't our responsibility. There's something beautiful about being able to go out there and help show the true version of your people. But at the same time, there's kind of that struggle and pressure to represent your people as a whole. So that's kind of that scene in Tashino when she's walking down the hallway and whatnot. I was just like, oh my goodness, I'm going to have a little breakdown here. But yeah, so that's kind of for me what I took away from those and how I reacted to them.
Yeah, we were actually discussing a bit earlier about being I think the three of us were just discussing about being in an institution and being a Native person and just being bombarded with all these questions. And people feel the right to ask you real personal questions, especially about your finances and whether you're going to school for free or not. It's crazy. I took 2 things away from that. For me, it's just as a Native person, whether you're from Vancouver or not, or from the traditional Musqueam, Tsleil-Waututh, and Squamish, you're never alone. Because as a Kwakwaka'wakw person, I've only been here for 2.5 years, and it's probably taken me a year to get to know more people from my nation, but I'm slowly getting to know more people and trying to learn my songs and everything. So whereas I might have felt alone at first, I'm slowly not being alone. And there's that sense of community from being an Indigenous. So in a sense, you are never alone when you're Indigenous. You'll always have a community no matter where you are.
I guess I'll go. with that line alone, it really makes me think about, you know, how I grew up and growing up as an oppressed person, because that's the reality of the situation when you're living in a colonial time, you know, this country was colonized, you know, and when I think about, you know, my identity and how it's kind of I always thought my identity is always transforming and changing, but at the same time, you know, it didn't matter if I was doing my master's, it didn't matter if I was a youth worker, it didn't matter if I'm teaching at the University of Saskatchewan, it doesn't matter, you know, if I'm back home in Paysplat, I'm always Anishinaabe, and that's what it comes down to. You know, I could be walking down the streets of Vancouver and someone will say, hey, there's a native, and throw all these stereotypes and ideologies about me. But when it comes to identity, my partner always says, the only person that's in charge of your identity is yourself. Because as Indigenous peoples, we are constantly being told who we are. And my partner always states, you know, we're called Indians, we're held under the Indian Act, we're called Native, we're called Aboriginal, we're called this, that, and the other thing. But what it really comes down to as identity is yourself as an individual. So when you say you're out there representing, you know, I'm representing Paysplat First Nation today, that isn't correct. I'm representing myself, Andrea Landry, as an Anishinaabe Kwe. And that's it. So, you know, this can also lead into politics. You know, when people say, you know, the chief represents me, the chief represents, you know, AFN's national chief, they aren't representations of us. They're representations of self. So for me, growing up in the city part-time, it was difficult. There was lots of racism. It was, you know, Thunder Bay, Ontario has the highest murder rate this year, and a lot of it is Indigenous peoples, and that city was torture for me growing up, and there weren't very many supports, but now that I look back on it, it's really allowed me to understand what being Anishinaabe is, you know, and it doesn't, there's no such thing to me as a two-world concept. It doesn't matter if you're, you know, in an institution or if you're out in your home community, you know, hunting or fishing, you're still Anishinaabe, you're still Cree, you're still Blackfoot, you're still whatever nation you come from. You know, and this whole two-world concept has kind of, again, compartmentalized us, you know, place us into these boxes, okay? When you're at home, you have to act like this, you know, and when you're in the city, you have to act like this. No, I'm going to act how I am as an Indigenous person, as an Anishinaabe Kwe. So with identity and with, you know, representation, all it really comes down to is the individual. And that's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Well, thank you for that. Thinking about, am I speaking loud enough? There we go. So for me, about being raised in your home community or not, I was born in Whitehorse, Yukon, and then I was raised by my two moms out in PEI in a really awesome community of lesbians. my mom's right there. You can give her a high five later. and then I've also just been like, but see, this is when it gets tricky, how much to disclose, right? And like it's my choices how I've interacted. Yeah, and like choose to represent myself. But I think in terms of being, like for claiming space, for instance, addresses specifically being an urban Aboriginal youth in Vancouver. And like I moved out here when I was 17 from Ottawa and was just, I don't know, sometimes you definitely, I don't know, like dropped out after my first year and then took some time off and then came back. But it's definitely, it is hard within, especially I found within academic institutions to, just find, feel like you're, doing okay on your path because you do continuously come up against, into these really, really strange dialogues of people wanting you to, explain. They want you to, they want to get an education from you about the infinitely complex current situation of indigeneity, global indigeneity, Canadian, and I mean, if you want to get into colonial borders and all, this is what I mean, and then instead of looking at the actual artwork or my ideas that I was interested in, a lot of times I would just end up becoming an educator, and that's not, it can be my responsibility, and sometimes I feel that it would be irresponsible for me not to engage with certain people, but at the same time, it's not really fair either. And I think that there is also a large movement going on now about unsettling the settler within and that kind of stuff. But being at UBC and being in this exhibit, I answered in in an interview too, is that like having work here before coming and starting my MFA here has been such an amazing opportunity to also just feel like I can feel at home here. It's been pretty great. And then also Bo Dick has a studio around the corner from mine, and that's just been like, yeah, I'm just like, I'm reading Kant and I don't understand, or like Hegel, and he's just like cuts through it. So I think that's the experience is getting better.
It's just so interesting to have such an array of answers, because you're all coming from such different experiences, and we have lots of common themes coming up, representation and urban indigeneity, but you've all got like completely different answers, and I think that's valuable for all of us, just to sit here and learn from each other, and I think for everyone in this room. And Janine, you're talking about this idea of art being inseparable from politics, and that's true. But then you're also like, this is also art, and I want to talk. Like, I want to be able to appreciate it for that. And we were all just like, we're not going to expect to break things down in ways that we don't want to, and we are just here to in a safe space to appreciate and learn about these things together. For traditional me specifically, are there any comments or questions in the audience, whether you just want to add to the discussion about the film, or whether you have any questions for the women here? Justin?
I was thinking kind of talk a little bit, maybe explore a little bit,
Can you stand and speak up?
Sure, sorry. Kind of the role of like our individual, we're doing represent ourselves. But I wonder on the other side of it, what the role is of kind of our accountability to our own communities and to our families and stuff like that. So maybe kind of share your insights into that. How is that coming to your kind of your work as artists and academics and just Indigenous people, and how that kind of ties into parts about being an individual, but also your family, your community, all behind you, in front of you, and beside you, and below you, and above you. So.
I'll start. I think I'm a sixth or fifth generation artist, way back to Charlie James and there's Ellen Neal, and then there's Dave Neal, my dad, David Neal. So I come from that line of artists whose work is actually in the MOA. So I too have to consider what role I play in my community and my lineage and what my artwork means in that. So you actually really got me thinking, like, what does it mean to have a picture of me just in my underwear in the museum that has my ancestors' artwork and great carvings? It's an interesting thing to think about. You made me think. How dare you?
For me, as an artist, I always just try and be as honest as possible. With my upbringing, I come from a really big fishing family on my dad's side. I don't have any artists that I know of other than my great-grandfather, who did it for a hobby. So in terms of representing, like taking on the role of kind of representing your home community, I never really go as far as that. I'm very proud to be Gitgat and proud that my family comes from Hartley Bay, but I will never say that this painting completely represents the opinions of everyone from our nation or anything like that. And I more so look to my direct family as inspiration for my pieces. As I said, I just try and really remain honest with my pieces and let everyone know that the work that I'm creating is coming from my heart, and that's you can take away what you please from that, and hopefully people relate positively to my work. So,
can you rephrase the question?
Me?
Yeah.
All right. I think. Or do you want me to, or Justin? Okay, well, what I think Justin was asking is, like, we're talking about representation. I think that his question was related to this idea of the previous question about standing alone, all of my people. Like, maybe what are your felt responsibilities? Are your perceived responsibilities to your ancestors? Your accountability to where you come from, to your community, and it's your decision what your community is or what that means, I think.
Yeah, it's a huge responsibility. It's massive. It's so much bigger than me. And I feel like as an artist, all I can do is be like as honest as I can be, and just try to talk with different family members and different people that I am lucky that I have that inspire me in my life, and just get some, like, help get guidance along the way. And but also that, like, I think it's really hard to avoid the fact that, like, yeah, we're in charge of our own identities, but we can't, it's really hard to control what people put on us, right? And what gaze they put on us, and the way that we're conducting ourselves and interacting with art forms and our traditions, and also just how we are on our paths. It's really hard to, so in that sense, I guess that's where accountability comes into play too.
I think this is a very important question. When I think about it, I think about, you know, non-Indigenous counterparts, whether they're academics or whether they're artists. And, you know, you take someone like Noam Chomsky, for example, and you ask yourself the question, do we ever think twice? Does Noam Chomsky represent his whole family and his whole community? Do we ever have to think that? But because we are Indigenous, you know, because we're in Anishinaabe, because we're Cree, specifically because of that, you're meant to represent your whole community. And where did that come from? Where did that concept come from? You know, and historically, you look at, you know, the chief systems and how they have dramatically transpired into a colonial system that continuously oppresses us. And they were the key representatives of our people, and now they're just, some of them are a big joke. So to me, it's that question, you know, where is it in time that Indigenous peoples, a single Indigenous person walking down the streets in the city of Vancouver, where has the accountability for them, you know, where has the idea come from that they represent every Indigenous person? Where has that idea and concept derived from? Yes, I hold myself accountable for when I speak about my community, when I speak about the politics going on in my community, when I speak about the battles that are constantly going on with chief and council back home. But I, again, recognize that I am an individual. And this concept of, because simply because you're Indigenous, you represent every Indigenous person in Canada. Canada. I don't call it Canada, but Canada, this colonial country of Canada, you know, and how do we shift this thing that's been, you know, again, this is how you're supposed to represent yourself. This is how, you know, so for example, everyone here, it's like me saying, okay, you represent everyone in your home community. You know, and why is that? And does the man working at the front desk represent everyone in his home community? Where has this concept come from? So that's kind of the question that's kind of come up for me. You know, it's just really floating around in my head, and maybe I'll do some more research into it. I don't know. But again, it's about, you know, self-identification.
Maybe we could do some research right now. are there any responses to this idea of accountability and what it might look like to the panelists?
I have a response about identity and in relation to Indigenous artwork, is that I think that it's problematic that a lot of times people, like you saying, like, why do I have to represent my entire community? Why is that an expectation? And in the same sense, I feel like that is used a lot with Indigenous artwork, is if you're making something and you put it out there, they're like, oh, this has to do with identity. And by saying that, like, oh, I'm really interested in the identity-based work that you're doing, it's like, well, is it identity-based work because it's an identity that you relate less to? Is it, are you, or I guess I shouldn't just throw yous around, but is it, I feel like it's like a blanket that's put on Indigenous artwork and it renders it into a state of other. And we all have our own individual positionalities. And like you said in the responses that you've gotten, they're all vastly different, even though we're all sitting here on this panel interested in a similar topic, and it's political. And that's just something that I'm also interested in researching further and considering, is this problem of putting that gaze or category onto people, onto us as Indigenous makers.
I'm going to be the really flower and hippie one. I mean, I'm going to be the positive one. I'm fucking proud that I am a Hauset. I'm just saying that. I'm proud that I'm a Hauset of Neutral, to be part of that community. So fuck yeah, am I going to represent that community. I am proud to be Kwalgeoth of the Kwakwaka'wakw Nation, of the Neal family. I want to represent them. Hell yeah. You feel I'm getting fired up here? This is not a bad fired up, by the way. It's just dialogue. It's debate. Of course, and I do think that every day as an artist, not as a person, like, just walking around, but as an artist, when I put work out there and I put my words out there, of course it's going to reflect my community and my family. All my teachings and my identity and who I am is because of that. And it's also because of my environment, you know, the whole nurture nature debate. Yeah. I'm really too fired up right now to, like, go on about that. But I do really think that we do have to put into consideration of our identity and our community as a whole, not either, like, one or the other.
Anger is a tool. Anger is totally a tool.
Anger
Use
is
it.
Not a bad thing.
Well, thank you for the conversation around this topic, because it's not a simple one. And I think that you've all talked about the nuance of this and how it's problematic, but how it's important, and also how it's something to celebrate. So it's diverse, and we could sit here for a long time just answering your question, Justin. Are there any other questions around this conversation in the audience, or any other inputs? All right. So, is there anything else that we want to say about this film, or are we ready to move on? Yeah, but I mean, this, like, I'm tasked with creating a structure out of films with filmmakers that aren't here, pretty much. But it's a good one. It's an exciting task and an interesting one. The next one, and we can jump around. It can be loose, but this is just for the sake of some structure. The next film, Who Am I by Victoria, which is the monologue by the woman from Fiji. She had a lot to say, and I know that we listened to it a little while ago. But I think it would be important, as the filmmaker wasn't here, for us to acknowledge that that we got to witness their art and that was shared with us. So I think we should talk about it a little bit and pay it that homage, while acknowledging that for these other films, the filmmakers aren't here. So why is it, like, to you, why do you think it was important to watch this film of a... of a woman from a different country across so many miles of ocean?
I found it to be incredibly powerful because there are so many parallels between what she's saying and the experiences that we have every day here. It was very nice to hear her say that you should take pride in your culture, and when she was asking herself, should I just try and fit in? I'm sure that most people in this room have asked themselves that at some point in their lives, and it was nice to see where she went with that. And she basically said, no, we should not try and fit in. We should celebrate our cultures and live that. It's really nice to meet people from other cultures who have similar experiences. Last year at the Frida Diesing School, we had a Maori artist, Derek Lardelli, come. And it was so incredible to learn more about his culture and realize how much we really do have in common with the Maori people. And it's nice to form those connections. I was able to educate myself more on their history, and so that's inspired me now to hopefully one day go learn more about their culture as well. So I found this film to be incredibly powerful, and I think that it was really important for it to be included in this piece, especially because she's coming from another world, I guess.
I think what it again comes down to is identity politics. Being born as an Indigenous person, a lot of people say you're automatically born into being a political, you know, something political, you know, and that's how you will remain the rest of your life. Being involved again in international work, I have seen heard a lot of the same stories around the world, you know, about identity politics and how young Indigenous peoples identify themselves. And again, it comes down to how we choose to be identified. Can we, you know, we have the choice of assimilating and becoming a part of, you know, colonial constructs and colonial systems, and you know, saying, I don't fit in here. Why don't I fit in? Or again, we can embrace ourselves and identify ourselves as we were meant to, as Indigenous peoples. You know, reclaim that identity that has been, you know, raped and murdered from our ancestors. And that identity is still there. So why are we even thinking of the concept of why don't I fit in? Because that identity is there. You know, it's in your DNA. It's ingrained in the soil of the lands that you live on. When it comes to identity, there's so many different conversations and discussions and different directions it can lead into. But I think the most important thing when it comes to identity politics is, again, you know, self. You know, identifying yourself as an Indigenous person. I wanted to say more, but I lost my track of thought. But that was the basics.
So we have just under 15 minutes left. So I think right now we will make a switch onto talking a little bit more about claiming spaces and about the work that was put in there. And like, I'm really sorry to not have time to talk about the other films. If there is time at the end, we can have more time for questions or dialogue. I want to thank the filmmakers for sharing those pieces. And feel free to include anything that you, any last thoughts about those films within what you have to say. But I think it's a good interlude to have just talked a little bit about Who Am I, Victoria's piece, because she's an Indigenous woman from a different part of the world living in a another colonial country. And it's just this, again, it's sharing into this dialogue of how we might be in conversation with each other. As we are in this panel, women who are doing very different things, but we're all here for the theme of our panel, which is the gaze, deconstructing the objectification of Indigenous women. I think so far we've talked about representation, we've talked about telling our own stories, we've talked about what we might owe to our communities, what we might owe to ourselves, and just this conversation, I think, is deconstructing the images that are made for us through diversity, through conversation, through art. But I'd like to end by asking you a little bit about your two pieces, because when I asked people if they'd seen the exhibit, almost everyone put up their hands. So I'd like just to start at the end and ask you to describe your piece and why you brought it to the exhibit.
Okay, so I have two pieces in the exhibit, The Male Gaze as well as Indian Doll. Where to begin? How many of you felt a little bit dizzy while standing in front of The Male Gaze? Perfect, so it was doing its job. With that piece, I really wanted to discuss the discomfort that Aboriginal women often feel while being subjected to the male gaze. And I wanted to create a piece that made the viewer very uncomfortable. So I created it to scale of a person somewhat, and I painted it in a way where you would look from head to toe, so you're mimicking the checking out motion that people do when they're checking you out. And I did extensive color research to find out what would make you feel ill while looking at it. And so it creates that kind of optical flashing effect. And that piece, I am very happy with all the feedback I've received from that piece, letting me know that it is indeed successful. With Indian Doll, that for me was, I don't know, I guess kind of a comment on my own identity struggle growing up, but one that I'm sure many young Aboriginal women can relate to. I often saw Indian dolls in my grandma's house, in my great auntie's house, houses, and was a little confused because they didn't look anything like how our traditional regalia looked. And then when I moved to Victoria, you go downtown and here there are all these Indian dolls and all these shops and tourists putting them in their bags and whatnot. So for me, I kind of just wanted to comment on how such an object can affect one's idea of identity. And for the specific canvas, I aligned it so that the dolls would mimic a conveyor belt, commenting on mass production of such an object, and then the beaded line on the side is a reference to the conveyor belt as well. So I think that kind of gives you guys an idea of where I'm coming from with those two pieces.
Are there any questions or comments in the audience about that piece? How about on the panel? Or are we just totally satisfied with you? You should know that, like, when I was asked to do this panel, I felt giddy because I went through that exhibit and took pictures of all of your work and looked at the artist names. I'm like, who are these women? They're so cool, so wonderful. And I took a picture of the gaze. I think it's really stunning. Yeah, I love that piece. So how about you, Elena?
Yeah, just thinking about your piece just made me feel sick. Just a photographic memory going on. My piece is the self-portrait over there. It's a really big picture of me. And it has a bunch of names of costumes that I found online. And I went back last night to a lot of the websites I found, and they're still up there. Such names as Naughty Navajo, Sexy Squaw, Pocahontas. People always love this one. Chief Wansome Tail. Yeah. And there's all these names like that. And, you know, it's just verbally objectifying Native women to seem like a thing that you can own. Like, there was names as My Little Indian Maiden. It's just sort of weird sexualizing of these costumes. And there's this dialogue on Tumblr. Yes, I go on Tumblr, a lot about how, like, the non-Indigenous people versus the Indigenous people, and I sort of saw that there's this sort of this blockage between these two groups because they couldn't come to an understanding of each other, and I sort of sought out that maybe if they can't talk this out or have any sort of debate about it, maybe there just should be a visual representation of what harm such costumes can do to a people and to Indigenous women. Hence why I made the photograph. I actually almost didn't make it in the show because it wasn't my intended piece. So that was a bit of chance and fate there, actually. That's all I have to say about the piece. It's pretty self-explanatory, I think.
I have to say I'm really happy about the positioning of your piece, Male Gaze, on... in relation to the untitled video. I think they really play off of each other nicely in that space. And then I feel like Wolf Cloak is another extension or a way to embody some of the ideas that I was working through with in the untitled film, which I've already talked too much about. Yeah, thanks.
Okay, I don't have any pieces in this exhibition, but I just wanted to know if I could just discuss this whole concept of the objectification of Indigenous women and how it's being utilized within artistic forms, because historically it wasn't even safe to be an Indigenous woman. And today it's still the same way. But now we've come to this point in time in our life where we're seeing the issues, you know, being explored in artistic ways within MOA or within different places around the world. You know, you have the Walking with Our Sisters as well, and the exhibits that they put on across the country. There's this new interesting paradigm that's beginning to formulate, though. And I think what it really resonates around is the concept of empowerment. The empowerment of Indigenous women, of being an Indigenous woman. Because, you know, when mainstream society thinks of Indigenous women, a lot of them tend to focus on, you know, missing and murdered Indigenous women, you know, the rape victims, you know, the bodies that are being dumped in the ravines, you know, those voiceless women. And we're really focusing on these issues. And for myself, I'm going to disclose with you, I myself am a victim of rape. But I am also a survivor of rape. And now you see this paradigm where Indigenous women are no longer looking at themselves as that victim. They don't want to be that victim anymore. For example, for your installment, with all the words that are placed against us as Indigenous women, you know, you're putting it in the faces of colonial society. And you're saying this is an injustice to the bodies and to the minds and to the spirits of Indigenous women. And we no longer need to play that role of victim. We no longer have to be that rape victim. We no longer have to be that squaw. We no longer have to be that Pocahontas. We've come to a point in time in our lives where there's this shift where that victimization and that oppression is slowly rising. And I think that by utilizing colonial spaces and utilizing, you know, spaces where we weren't allowed to show our faces historically, that's where the change is coming, you know, and that the systems in place are so ingrained with colonial thought and oppression. But we as Indigenous women are really shifting that. You know, we no longer want to be oppressed. We no longer want to be victimized. You know, we want to be revolutionaries. That's what I want to be. I want to be a revolutionary, man. And then that's all I need.
Thank you, Andrea. And thank you to the rest of you for your time. I think that we ended on an important note. I just think it's a really important opportunity that we all took today to have a panel on, like, objectification, representation of Indigenous women, but telling it through the stories of art and telling it through the stories of artists and through the lens of resurgence. I think that's the narrative that we ought to focus on, is the power of our women and the power of resurgence and of art. So thank you for sharing this time with me, with us, to discuss these films. Thank you for sharing your art in the exhibit. Thank you for sharing your words and your film. It's a real honor to sit with you all, and thank you for your interactions as an audience and for listening so well, because these conversations are important. So, haichka osiem.
Wow. I was trying to think of what to say and how to thank them. I think that was an extremely powerful discussion. A lot of those issues hit home with me, and I'm sure they did a lot of other people. So thank you all to Kelly, Elena, Janine, Celia, and Andrea. What you shared with us was very, very important. And on that note, just ending, I want to encourage all of you to take this knowledge with you, not to leave it in this room, but to take it with you and share it with other people, to think about it, and to teach others what you learned today, because this is an extremely important issue that we all need to deal with and that we all need to take with us and carry with us and take that responsibility as witnesses in this room, to take that responsibility and to continue sharing. So on that note, we're going to take a very, very short break. We're going to come back at 2:45, a quick coffee break, a quick washroom break. And the next session is Real Medicine, which will be environmentalism and youth activism. So we will begin right at 2:45. Thank you, Gayla Kessler. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. For those of you just joining us, welcome for the last session. As an uninvited guest, I take the responsibility to once again acknowledge that we are on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people. Just before we get started again, we would like to draw your attention to the Twitter feed, and you can hashtag claiming space, and you can look at what's been going on with the exhibit, what's been going on with this conference during this time. So once again, hashtag claiming space. And as of tomorrow, this conference will be live on the MOA, or it won't be live, it will be a webcast. It is being live, streamed live right now, and that'll be on the MOA website. So this next session is called Real Medicine, Environmentalism, and Youth Activism. This session moderator will be Matthew Ward. Matt is an Indigenous student at UBC from Drift Pile Cree Nation. He is studying First Nation Studies and political science, and he is currently the president of the First Nation Studies Student Association, which does amazing work across campus and within the Indigenous community. This session will end at 4:30, so I would like to invite Matt up, please. Thank you.
Hello. Can everyone hear me okay? Am I talking loud enough? Is this... Okay, obviously I'm very nervous, so I apologize. So welcome to Real Medicine, Environmentalism, and Youth Activism. I'd like to thank Rebecca for keeping everything running on time. I'd also like to thank Kelsey Sparrow for the wonderful invitation onto the territory today. I tried to root all the work that I do here in the fact that we are on the traditional, ancestral, unceded territory of the Musqueam people. And so I ask that we try to keep that in mind as we move forward in our discussions today. I'd also like to thank MOA. I've never done anything like this before. I'm really excited. There's been some great conversations happening so far, and I'm just really honored to be a part of it, so thank you. Also, as we talked about the live stream, my mom, hi mom, is watching. She's watching live from Slave Lake, Alberta, so yeah, thanks mom, I love you. So I'm really looking forward to this discussion. We have a bunch of great panelists here today. I'm sure they'll offer us a lot of great things to think about, talk about, and especially in considering the intersections between environmentalism and youth activism. I'll introduce the panelists and films quickly, and we'll have a screening and move into the discussions afterwards, much as the previous sessions have gone. We have Bridget DePape, who is well known for her, or Bridget DePape, sorry. Who is well known for her 2011 protest during the throne speech holding the sign Stop Harbor. She has since been an active ally, and she's an activist around environmental issues here in Canada, so I appreciate you coming out today. I'd also like to welcome Emilio Wawati. He's an Anishinaabe from Gitigan Zibi, who is one of the activists, or artists, in this exhibit next door. We'll also be watching one of his films today. We also have Cody LaCoy, who's an artist in the Claiming Spaces exhibit. It's he's been the recipient of two consecutive scholarship awards with the YVR Arts Foundation in 2011 and 2012. Cody submitted two acrylic paintings that addressed environmental issues and urban landscapes, and they're beautiful paintings. I'm sure you guys have seen them in the exhibit next door. So the films we'll be watching today, we have In Your Heart by Raymond Kaplan. It's a beautiful short animation piece. He's also featured in the exhibit next door with a separate short animation piece. We have Anishinaabe Aki by Emilio Wawate. As noted, he's on the panel today with us today. And we have Mana, or Now, by Art Circuit, and it's contributing a northern experience in these conversations of environmentalism and youth activism. So without further ado, I guess we'll watch the films and then move into a discussion shortly after. Thanks.
Algonquins against Algonquins, and then there's Algonquins against Crees or Mohawks, and that's what we gotta stop. You know what I mean? We gotta try to come together, because this is traditionally, this is all our land. This is unceded territory, obviously. You know what I mean? The land's dying because the people are dying. And we're losing contact with ourselves because we're not even on the land anymore. We're living in reservations.
All right, it's a great day to be Indigenous. Give yourselves a round of applause. I want to know who's all in the house. Lux and all. Eagle Village. We are the first people. We are the Anishinaabe. We are the caretakers. When we want to sit at the table and talk nation to nation, we are told, put in a land claim. And we say, why should we put in a land claim when it is our land? The land claims require that we extinguish our rights. And as you know, we have been told by our elders, you cannot extinguish what you don't own, because it is owned by the Creator.
Yeah! Yeah!
You just skin it like this.
Just skin it?
Yeah, and then you just pull it,
the
skin.
Well, we went to the march 2 days ago.
Yeah.
We brought the cameras and stuff, and we did interviews.
I met the Grand Chief, too.
By being a youth and appearing and listening, It means a lot just by doing that, because it shows that you care about your people and your own culture and your future. And you do care about the past too, and that's why you're there and to listen. Do you see any divisions between the Anishinaabe Nation?
It is very true that there is tremendous division, sometimes even within communities. There's division among the nation, between the communities, because of our governments also. Now yes. We've allowed governments to treat us, to divide us. It's really to divide and conquer.
I blame the government, because they are divided, you know. Mm-hmm. Even families, you know, one community will try and get more out of the government, you know. But what's underneath that, you know? What are you losing underneath? You forgot this. Where is it? And then that's when the division starts, because it's been covered up. We have to start digging and pulling out everything, you know, that has been buried.
One thing that governments and no one else has been able to take away from that, and that's our spirit that lies inside of us as an Anishinaabe. As long as we maintain that fire, we will be able to pass it on and welcome people, both native and non-native, into the circle of healing that we all have to be a part of.
You could feel your spirit just being surrounded by your people, getting together for what you want and what you believe in. When we were there together, our ancestors were there with us too. I could actually feel my spirit circulating within me.
You're still an Indian no matter where you are.
totally sympathetic. Anywhere you go, you're still an Indian, it's your land. That's why you feel the spirit when you go other places.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's your land, that's why. When you go over there, you don't feel bad when you go outside, because it's your land. Its only problem is the white man living it in it. So you're still an Indian no matter where you go. The spirit is there. Wherever you go. That's why.
Thank you.
Now you do yours.
Hi, Mom, again. And hello, everybody else, too. Okay, so I guess with that, we'll get started. It seems that last film cut out a little bit short with the credits. I'm not sure if that was a technical thing, but yeah, it's a great film. You can find it online. So without further ado, I gave a brief description about you guys, but I was wondering if maybe we could go down the line and have you guys introduce yourselves and maybe talk a little bit about the work you do or your pieces within Claiming Space. Cool, thanks.
My name's Cody Gokoi. I'm from Penticton. I'm living down in Vancouver studying fine art right now. And I've been mainly drawn to painting. And I could talk about my pieces a bit, and I'll just keep it brief, overall theme of what sort of inspired me to make the work, and then see what else I have to say later on. I'll talk about the Lionsgate Bridge piece in the exhibit. It's really made about the environment of the urban setting and also the way I make art is it's sort of a visual take on kind of how I'm feeling in the broader sense of environmentalism, which I've been drawn to making art for recently, more specifically the possible fossil fuel expansion that's happening in this area. So for me to think about that issue, it's not so much done in theoretical conceptual space, but more as a way to link what's happening outside me and connect it in visual metaphors so that I can internalize it and reproduce something that sort of speaks for itself in that sense. And that's sort of how I approach my artwork.
Cool, thank you very much. Amelia?
Hold it like this? No, just kidding. Is this okay? Hello, check one, two. No, just kidding. What? No, it's okay, yeah. All right. Hello, everybody. My name is Emilio Wawadi. I'm a music student. I made the film Anishinaabe Aki about 5 years ago. Yeah, more or less. The idea came to me actually out of frustration of a combination of both the struggles that my community is constantly undergoing and also a lot of discrimination that I faced growing up from both native and non-native. It sounds weird, but yeah, growing up in a town in northern Quebec, I was discriminated by the Cree to the north, not all of them, but a good portion, and people from my own communities, and also the French people. And so when I came about with the idea of this film, it was nothing like how the film turned out, so it was pretty interesting. But essentially, I just really want to voice out my concerns about, you know, what's going on at home and what's going on in us as individuals. And, you know, I just, yeah.
Hi, my name is Brigitte. Thank you so much for hosting this panel. And thank you so much to the other panelists. And thank you as well for hosting this amazing program. And to the speakers who came before us, such amazing, powerful women. Thank you so much for your words. And I also want to thank Elmaya Tailfeathers, who is the person who connected me to all of you, and for the amazing work that she's doing. I also want to acknowledge the unceded territories that we're on of the Musqueam people and thank them, knowing that we're here uninvited, and to thank them for allowing us to be here. I'm originally from Winnipeg, and I now organize here in BC. I'm an activist and community organizer, and I'm learning what it means to practice solidarity and to be an ally with different Indigenous communities who are fighting the crises that we're facing around colonialism as well as around climate change.
Awesome. Thank you for those lovely introductions. You were much more graceful than I was, so I appreciate that. So I guess we'll start. I have a couple sort of jotted down notes and ideas about where this discussion could go, but it's not about me. It's about you guys. So if you guys have any questions for the panelists about the films or about their work, feel free to raise your hand now. No one. Okay, great. Awesome. That's exactly what I wanted to have happen. Okay, so we'll move into, I guess, a discussion on one of the films. I'm going to start with the one that made me laugh the most, which was Mana, or Now. And just maybe if I could pick your brains on your thoughts on that film, the one with the guy, credited as the guy, his name's Jackie, and his running shoes. If you had any comments on that film, I thought it was an interesting exploration of the burden of responsibility that is often placed on Indigenous peoples, and due to sort of the intricate relationships to land that communities have. And maybe you guys could talk a little bit about your work and maybe how it is associated with land or territory, or just the film in general.
Yeah, I was drawn to that film in the way that it represented sort of these seemingly unnoticeable details we go through during our life. And what connected to me to that film was the sound of the snow and how that can be such a memorable experience for people just to hear that again, and then kind of transports you to that place and time. And for me, I've never been up north at all. And I felt the filmmaker did a real good job of portraying the elements that are involved in that emissions that he was concerned about, and how you know, it's in the air for him and his community. And even though I've never had that experience of living a life like that, I can relate and be in solidarity with him for the chance that it's air, it's water, it's what we breathe and we live, and he was really drawn to that, and it compelled him and it activated him to move and do his part, as he said at the end. And I thought it was really simplistic but encompassing in its scope.
Agreed.
Yeah, I thought it was so funny and brilliant, and it made me laugh. I really liked how you saw at the beginning where he was looking at the computer screen and he was seeing the changes, and I perceive that as different changes in climate change and greenhouse gas emissions, and then to see him act on that. But I do feel that with our generation, we're exposed to this knowledge that the human family is being threatened with climate change, and specifically, yeah, that there are impacts, especially for northern communities and Indigenous communities who are feeling it the most. So it also, in a way, revealed this sense of injustice or environmental injustice, where the people who are least responsible, like that community, for example, one of the least responsible for climate change, relatively speaking, compared to like more industrialized areas, is also feeling the impacts the most. And yet you see him taking his part to make that change. And I think that's really inspiring. And in my experience, I've seen so many young people who are really rising to this challenge. And in many ways, it is Indigenous communities who are leading this struggle. And we're seeing that, for example, yesterday there was a young woman from UBC, Shannon Hecker, who organized this rally in solidarity with Elsie Puktuk. And knowing that, you know, just last year that was happening, it's the 1 year anniversary, and it was in many ways many Indigenous women who were leading that and protecting the land and who were standing up. And because of the courage of women like that and of people like that in communities, it led to a moratorium now on fracking. There's a moratorium in Nova Scotia. Now there's one being proposed for New Brunswick. And it's amazing. And we see how change is really happening. And there is, we are really in revolutionary times. I love what you had said about, like, yeah, wanting to be revolutionaries. I really feel that too.
One of the things I really enjoyed about that film is, seeing how the young Inuit man took it upon himself, you know, to go out and just do these little things like turn off the skidoo, turn off the truck. It's interesting because, you know, you got to start somewhere, right? You know, it might just be turning off keys and essentially turning off the whole power of the town, but, you know, in a sense, it would almost be like going back to the old ways, you know, living without electricity, you know, not having to worry about the pollution, and just, I don't know, it's interesting because, you know, he takes it upon himself to go out there and bring change and be the change that he wants to see in the world, you know what I mean? And there's a lot of young people, well, all of us here, we want to see that change, we're trying to be that change, you know, we're trying to break the cycle of, you know, oppression, and we're doing that through art, and coming from First Nations or Indigenous cultures, you know, they're very artistic cultures, so essentially it's already in our blood, it's in our DNA, it's in our genes, you know, and now in today's modern society, there's different forms of art and different ways to express it, and especially in the future, like, we preserve our culture, our language, everything with film. And we can get our messages out there. And the cool thing I find about film is that it's like you give a camera to a Native person or an Indigenous person, you're giving them the power. You know what I mean? Now they can go and tell their story through their eyes with their voice and not have some person come in and, you know, just basically what they were saying, have someone else tell our stories for us and more than half the time get it wrong. And I really enjoyed that about the film, seeing how it was just, you know, going around and turning off skidoos, but he's taking initiative. You know, it's the first step that you got to do. And I think as Indigenous people, you know, you're kind of born into this activist lifestyle, you know, coming from the bush, you know. It's your home, it's your life, it's who you are, it's where you're from. You need to protect that, you know. You're, what, 80% water. You know, you need to protect your water. You can't survive without water. It's common sense. But, yeah, I got a little off topic, but hey.
No, I appreciate that. Yeah, you all had really awesome things to say about that. And it's interesting how we see things such as, like, it's only turning off the skidoo, or it's only, but it's political action, and and it can be small like that and still be significant. So I appreciate that insight. Do we have any questions from the audience at this point in time? Yes, Celia.
Yeah. I think that it's very intentional that it wasn't just that the act of conservation had to do with something that had great risk for these people, so it wasn't like, okay, you're going to turn off your taps when you brush your teeth. Like, these, like, small actions had, like, serious consequences. So, like, that, like, they had their truck on because, like, anyone who's lived up in the cold because it's negative 40, and it needs that to start. And so it's not an easy, like, small act of conservation. It has a big consequence. And I think what you're saying is, like, or like Bridget, when you said that they looked out at the world and they thought that these northern people were contributing such a small amount, but they were willing to sacrifice so much. It's commenting, I think, on this burden that Indigenous people have. And so there is this notion of Indigenous stewards of the land, but it's a lot of responsibility. And so what do you, like, on this panel, and given the nature of the theme, like, what are your kind of thoughts on this burden and on how much these people might be needing to sacrifice versus, like, how much responsibility falls on Indigenous people, and where does this responsibility come from? when is it a burden, when is it just our job?
Great question. Comments? No, but yeah, exactly right. Going back to what Bridget was saying, and unfairly and overwhelmingly, these sort of burdens are falling on Indigenous peoples and Indigenous communities, and they're usually the first ones to respond to these issues. So thank you for clarifying that these small acts are actually a huge, especially in an Indigenous context. Are there any other questions in the audience, or should I be reflecting back on my notes? Okay, we'll go back to my notes. Oh, sorry, did you have a question?
I was wondering what you did your film 5 years ago, like what you had done with the film after you produced it, and if you can briefly also talk about, besides like what prompted you to create the film, who gave you the camera that you're speaking of that gave you the power to speak your own voice?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I'd like to thank, you know, my family for being my mentors and actually being there raising me culturally in the Anishinaabe way. And I'd like to thank Wabaguni Mobile from Montreal, because without them, I wouldn't be here. You know, they really helped me as an artist. See, I'm a musician. I didn't think I was going to become a filmmaker. Like, it just happened. But it's amazing. You know, the Wabaguni Mobile is international now. They're traveling all around the world. They've sent me to like New York City 3 times, Finland. You know, they gave, well, not just me, but First Nations youth from all across Quebec and now Canada and South America, the power to, well, to be creative, you know, to establish themselves as artists, to express themselves, you know. And I think without Wabaguni Mobile and other organizations like that, Indigenous people would not be able to have their voices heard, you know. And we live in the age of technology, and you know, it's a good combination to, well, it's good to combine both culture and technology at some points, not to the point where technology will overshadow culture and tradition, but let's say making language videos and whatnot, you know, those are the benefits of technology. But then, you know, there's also a lot of downfalls. You know, you have news cameras, people put out propaganda, you know, it goes hand in hand. Whoever has the camera more than often controls the power. Thank you.
Yes, please.
It'll be targeted towards Emilio, but eventually to the others as well. I know that in Kikong ZB you have tons of really powerful, I guess you could say representatives of your community. So Gabriel Whitegap and Claudette Commanda come to mind when I think of your community. What was the response like from your community, and how supportive were they with this film? And to the others, whether you're producing pieces of art or whether you're out there doing the activist work, what kind of support do you guys get from your home communities?
Well,
go for it.
Actually, it's funny that you say that, because beforehand, I hadn't really... My communities, I guess you could say, never really thought about me much, in a sense. But when I came out with this film, I actually got a lot of support from both my communities, and I still do get a lot of support, and I'm still very involved with my community. And in a sense, it actually made me closer to my communities by projecting and showing them what I see, the problems I see, and from what I understand. Now they realize, you know, it was cool, because after I finished it, it was almost like, oh crap, what did I do? It's like, oh man, I was like, I think I just stepped on people's feet. But no, it had to be said, you know. Things like this need to be brought up, like with the elder woman Maggie said in my film, was, you know, these things have to be brought up. You know, if the more you keep burying them, you know, the more problems and complications it's going to bring, you know. But I do get a lot of support from my community, but that's because I've chosen to give back as well. You know, I go back, I help with the young, I help the young kids. I try to inspire them. I try to, you know, there's not a lot of good role models. There's not a lot of successful ones. And I am from Kitigan-Zibi, but I was raised in Barrier Lake, which is further in the bush, and which is where I practice most of my culture, you know, medicine, hunting, fishing, trapping. You know, I haven't done a lot of trapping lately, obviously, because, you know, but by, how would I say, by throwing myself into my culture and practicing it as much as possible and then encouraging the younger people to practice it as well, I feel like I've gained a lot of respect, not just from like people my age, but also from the elders now from my community. And to me, that's like the greatest thing. It's an honor. You know, it wasn't easy, that's for sure. But, hey.
I'm interested in, expanding that question to the other panels as well and how your work is perceived through your own communities and your own through your work and its like political implications, I guess.
Okay. I would draw upon strongly my community for inspiration through the land, as Emilio mentioned, and how my perspectives have changed from viewing it as so, as a source of wealth in that regard. And it wasn't till I was really in Vancouver and away from Penticton that I began to notice sort of the richness that is rooted in those lands. And to say about my community, it would have to not so much take up the whole scope of you know, being ambassadors for your community or to that regard, but just where I find my painting and where I find my journey of being active and being active in the issues that are in my heart. I feel the two are one and the same, like my practice of furthering art and learning is rooted in where I'm connected to in environmental issues. And I guess support has come from my family in that way. And I'd like to give a big thanks to my younger brother who's here. Like, surprised me in that way. So, like, support comes that way, and I just feel that can be felt and received through your family members when you're, you know, pursuing a life that you want to better yourself and you want to live a healthy life and impact those around you in a good way. That you know, they're there for you, and you can take that with you, and that builds community, and that's how I am seeing it at this point.
Awesome, thank you, Bridget. Do you have anything to add on your experiences?
Yeah, I think I'd say that for me and my experience with activism, especially, for example, when I was working in the parliament as a page, it was sort of my first public activism. It was like coming out as an activist almost. I found that community was so important because I find sometimes this work can be very intimidating and can be scary. And when I first came to understand, you know, what the Harper government was doing, especially around cuts to environmental protection, around colonization, around criminalization of people of color, cuts to refugee healthcare, and started to understand as well what was happening with the tar sands and the violations of Indigenous rights. I really came to learn that from the community that I was part of at the time, which was the academic community, which was a good friend of mine who brought pictures back home and showed us and introduced us to people who had been living in Fort Chip and Fort McMurray and meeting those people and, you know, going to protests with Algonquin people who were protesting the logging in their community,
those were all moments of teaching and learning. And I think it's from those experiences with that community that you gain strength and you gain a sense of togetherness, and that's what sort of like nourishes the work. And I certainly feel that now as well. And just to respond to what you were saying around responsibility, I definitely can't speak to, you know, different indigenous communities what their responsibility is, but I do can speak to settler communities, and I do think that there is a huge responsibility there. And there's this really great graphic that a friend of mine made for Briar Patch, and it essentially is like a settler treaty card. And it talks about how, you know, oftentimes people are like, oh, you know, indigenous rights or indigenous issues, oh, it's just like indigenous peoples, and it's just like their responsibility. And it's like, no, actually, like, settlers have this huge responsibility in that relationship, in treaties, for sure, where, you know, a lot of the times the settler community is not responding to the promises that have been made, but also, like, beyond that, in terms of, like, calling out the systemic injustices and also standing in solidarity with communities when they are, you know, taking action to prevent further colonization. But yeah, just still learning what that looks like and that practice. And I think it's sort of like a friendship process, that, like, solidarity relationship of, like, listening and learning and going forward together.
Yeah, awesome, thank you. You kind of ticked off my question that I had on my notes, so that's one less thing I get to bring up. Sorry, did you want to add on to that? Oh, okay, great. Were there any other questions from the audience that would like to speak up? Okay, well then I'm kind of interested in, sorry, this is based more on the works with claiming spaces. My apologies, Bridget, but thinking about your work, my experience of it is that it's very political for myself. Have you always seen your work as political, or is that something that it kind of turned into? Either or, whoever wants to start. Yeah, sorry, okay, simpler. Have you always seen your work as political, as like as an activist, or is it something that it kind of turned into, or something that you kind of turn on with your work? Like, do you decide that?
Actually, to tell you the truth, growing up in around Barrier Lake, there's always been broken promises, and you know, I've seen the community struggles, and from a very young age, my mom and my cocom used to bring me to protests at Indian Affairs office down in Gatineau. And I was so young, I didn't even know what the heck a protest was. I was just like, yeah, like, fight the power. No, it's good. But yeah, I guess, like I said, essentially it's our upbringing, you know what I mean? Like, I was raised by my grandparents out in the bush for like the first 5-6 years of my life. And even after that, like, I still go to the bush and spend so much time there. And I think, it just really turns out that way because it's how I was brought up. You know, it's, my grandfather taught me about, you know, the history between Canada and, you know, First Nations people and prophecies, everything. And so it kind of just, for me, it kind of just turns out that way because I was brought up that way.
Yeah, that's great. That's a perfect response.
But actually, I wanted to say one thing about what you said a while ago. When it comes to, like, the responsibility for Indigenous peoples, the responsibility for protecting the environment and compared to settler mentality, it's really that whole upbringing. I can't say that, you know, settlers have no connection to the land, but it's a different kind of relationship. You know, and for, you know, since time immemorial, we've been so intimately connected with the land, the water. I mean, obviously the air, but, you know, but it's just, it's who we are. You know, we come from the land. We are the people of the land. And so it's understandable to me now. I understand why most settlers or Caucasians or non-natives won't understand where we're coming from when we don't agree with mining, when we don't agree with damming. You know what I mean? Because, you know, if you weren't brought up that way to understand and respect the environment and to essentially be one with the environment and the land, you obviously won't understand the difference. Well, you won't understand why you would want to protect it, and how do you say, you wouldn't know the difference between getting a job and making money and realizing that you need clean water. But if you get this job, this is the job that actually contaminates your water and this and that. So you're making money, but you're pretty much not reassuring your future. You know what I mean? It's money over life, essentially. But yeah. Yeah.
I would say I approach my art from a political perspective in mind as an endpoint. And it would never really be from a position of us and them too much when I'm making my art, because the art from a voice within it doesn't concern others too much when it's being made in that way. So when I when I'm drawn to the issues that I'm interested in, it creates you know, a life of its own and a birth of an idea, and the way I bring that idea to life is through my way of life. So it's really accountable to where I am in the political sphere. So it's an expression, a reaction, a revolt, and dream for, you know, further possibilities of where we take ourselves. So I wouldn't just label myself a political artist in that way.
Awesome, thank you for your responses. Do we have any questions from the audience? Anything at all? Yes. Yeah.
Okay. As loud as I can. I really appreciate that you brought hopes and possibilities and dreams into the space. And I just want to posit the question to the people on the panel about what do you hope for? What do you hope to see and dream through your art, and also just
Yeah, so for people that couldn't hear that, Manuel was asking, what are your hopes and dreams? You guys have brought a lot of possibility into this space through your conversations and through your work. What do you see as the possibilities and hopes for the future then of this work, I guess? Yeah, Bridget, if you want to start.
Thank you so much for that beautiful question. I feel like the I Don't Know More movement was a really amazing space that brought out new possibilities. I'm originally from Winnipeg and just saw a lot of racism there. And it was really amazing to go back just this past, or I guess 2 years ago now, and see Portage Place Mall, it's like super consumer center, transformed from the I Don't Know More movement, where you had people round dancing and drumming and this like amazing celebration of culture, and you had Indigenous people and allies hand in hand in the round dances. And to me that was sort of amazing and transformative, and I think speaks to the possibility of a different kind of relationship, away from this colonial relationship where it's about dominance. And we see how at the root causes of many of the problems we're seeing, like around climate change, around colonialism, it's this relationship of dominance. But I think what I Don't Know More brought was the possibility of equal relations with the land, equal relations with one another, but also a recognition of difference and a recognition of Indigenous rights, where Indigenous people have rights that non-Indigenous people don't, like the Chilcotin court decision just affirmed, which is amazing. So I'd say those are some dreams. A moratorium on fracking would be one, for sure, seeing that being a possibility for here. More direct democracy, a youth-led movement where we really decide what we would like our generation to look like and how that's different from previous generations.
I would have to say I have a dream in simple terms of just a reconnection with my homeland, which is in Penticton, and really just learning those the certain languages and the ways that lives before have lived on that place, and in speaking of contemporary terms of our mythologies today, like they're not distant recorded stories. There was an event recently at the place I'm living, which is in the Chinatown area, and it's artist residency, and it's called Squatches. And it's a Squamish word for the waterlands of that place, and they were seen as sacred sort of portals to the underworld, and being at the mouth of a river is very lush. So that site specific nature of that shows how we can really live with a foot in our upbringing and bring it into contemporary settings, and it enriches the life. So for me to learn about the Okanagan languages and ways, and just the few hints that I've heard have spurred many thoughts, because the language is very tied in visual metaphor, and being an artist, I just gravitate towards that, and it's like a whole way of being that isn't gone in a sense, and we're here to just bring it forward and continue that legacy in simple ways, even if it's just bringing language back to the places where they exist today in the city, that reclamation of ways of life and resurgence is my main dream to see, because I know what it wells up inside of me and what it activates within my body to move in a way. So I would like to be a part of that however I can, whether it's working with youth or just being a part of it.
Awesome, thanks. Emilio, do you have anything to add? What are your hopes for the future?
Well, one of the things I'd really love to see is the history books rewritten have, instead of having the story of standing from the east and looking to the west, I want to be able to read in a history book our side of the story, standing from the west and watching them come from the east. I want to have. I want to be able to go home to the bush after I'm done school. I want to be able to build a cabin and not be disturbed by logging or mining. Desecrated burial grounds. There's so much, I wish that the Canadian curriculum would be rewritten. Not against us, but at least to help benefit us. Because it's not easy for being First Nations and living in the city, trying to maintain your culture and your language, being away for so long. It's not might not be residential school, but you're still away for so long. You know what I mean? It's hard. Like, we don't get time off to go practice our culture. You know what I mean? And so it's easy for it to fade away. But then once you start practicing, it comes right back. It's in you. But the thing that sucks is not being able to practice it. It's being restricted. I just like to hear our side of the story written in history books now. Written by us and told by us and taught in schools. The truth, I guess. That's what I'd like to see. I'd like to see that change. I'd like to see Canada man up and tell the world the truth. And then we could move on. And then we could finally move on together once the past is acknowledged. That's what I want to see.
Awesome, thank you. Yeah. Wow, that was awesome. Acknowledgement of the amazing work that has happened and continues to happen, but also acknowledging that there's still a lot of work to be done. So I appreciate that. Do we have any questions from the audience?
Yes. Excuse me. I don't know if it's a question, but I'd love to hear all of your response, but it's an image that comes out of your film, Emilio, that I wonder if you could build into some kind of response. When I don't know what the animal was, a muskrat or a beaver?
A beaver.
And so when you're there starting to hide it, and maybe taking a little, not enough flesh off, that then you're sort of instructed in this, I thought, profound way by your auntie or mum or...
My grandmother.
Your grandmother. That there was something so powerful in that exchange, both about the land and about knowledge of the land, but also generational knowledge, ancestral knowledge, if I could. And it's really sticking in my head. And I'm wondering if you all want to respond about moments that you can see that kind of exchange that both brings in culture, people, land. There's just that image I thought was really, really powerful.
Yeah.
Whoa. Sorry. Wow. Yeah.
Present to us all.
I think I'm gonna try and reword it. And so, correct me if I'm wrong. Looking at ways in which traditional ancestral knowledge is intersecting with and sort of contemporary exchanges. What those. Like maybe whether that's through film or through art or through dialogue, through protest, through activism, is that kind of encapsulating what? So do you guys have any sort of thoughts on that? I think maybe I can take this question and expand on it a little bit more. I've been thinking a lot about placing these conversations about environmentalism in urban spaces. And how a lot of these dialogues happen in places where there's this sort of very strong disconnect from the land. Do you see that as a kind of a good thing in like asserting or reminding these sort of like traditional ideas of land in relationship to land in those spaces, or are those dangerous places for those conversations? Should these conversations be moved into spaces like back onto the land?
Yeah, I would come from the point of kind of the yin and yang for me is strongly rooted in just being in the city right now, and it's like I don't notice what I have till I'm away, and for that reason, I would like to mention earlier about the trickster in the movie and what that creature brought to the table when it said it's good, bad, evil, and it plays these tricks to show people, you know, what not to do. And in light of that, you show them what to do. So I've had a strong underlying current in my work of feeling split between these two these two ways of, you know, being in the city, because it's, you know, it's where I'm pursuing what I want to do right now, and the resources are there, and it to come back to the beaver image, being in the city, you can be removed from the production of certain things. Like, you can just, it's there because it's plentiful and you're not necessarily seeing it where it's coming from. And that hits me hard with the fracking communities and how you're not fully, you know, compensated for what's being, you know, taken from, and it's not being put back in the community. And as a way, I feel almost like we're, you know, the recipients of that wealth, and it only adds to our responsibilities to you know, make the most of what we have right now. And to be in the presence of an elder, knowing what to do with the beaver, I wouldn't know where to start. And I'm in the city, I've gone hunting maybe once, and the only thing I catch around here is a bus, and so it's just like you're way on the end of the spectrum, so you try to come to the middle point, and that's where the land is, the beginning of it, everything. Like, it has the culture, it has the language, and it's the root. So if you're not there, like, try to be there and bring it forth where you live. And like, I think that's where the transformation for me occurs, is having an experience, and then it changes you, and you look at things different. So the city's not limited to just being that abundant resource. You're able to come from a different perspective and utilize what's there for you.
Well, I think it's very important to bring that topic up in cities, in urban areas, you know, the importance of the environment. You know, I still from time to time, I still face racism because I'm native. You know, like with the whole free education, this and that. People only see this. People only see, like, oh, they don't pay taxes. You know, they get free education. They get this, they get that. Oh, they're just a bunch of drunks. It's like, no, man. You know why? Because so much shit has happened. You know why that person's a drunk? It's probably because they got abused and went to residential school. You know, there's so many reasons as to why things are the way they are now. And I think it's important to go out into the cities and remind people how important the environment is. Because, yeah, you can emphasize the importance of the environment when you're in the bush. But how are you going to get the word out there to the world? You know, the world needs to remember that, you know, Mother Earth is a living organism, you know, and she takes care of us, but we're not taking care of her. And coming back to what you were talking about, the transferring of knowledge, you know, growing up, you know, in my early teens, my mid-teens, I didn't think too much about culture. You know, I was more into my hockey and then just started playing guitar and stuff. And so I was in my phase where I wasn't really caring too much. But after a certain point, it started to get to me. And it really bugged me. And now, you know, I may not be a rich man, but I feel rich with knowledge because I've spent time with the elders and my grandparents. Learned so much from them. I still have a hard time getting by financially, but I know for a fact that I can go back to the bush and just go live, not have to pay rent, not have to worry about someone coming to evict me. I mean, you'll have those loggers, but I'm going to evict them out, man. I'm going to kick them out. I've done it before. You know, how would you say, working with my kokum and other elders and, you know, helping them, whether it be picking the medicine in the bush or on set a net or going hunting and doing all the work, you know, cutting up the moose, gutting it, you know, it's so rewarding. You know, it's knowledge that's been passed down for millennia, for so long. You know, and I ask people, yeah, do you ever go hunting? It's like, oh, no, I just go buy my food at the grocery store. It's like, yeah, well, you know, people have talked down on me because I go hunting. It's like, oh, you eat cow. You know, it's butchered and not treated with respect, and it's handled without care. But when we go out hunting, we take our time, we respect the animal, we put down tobacco, we say a prayer. You know, it's all about the respect. It's not the idea of going out and shooting an animal for fun and just having a good time. It's about going out there and practicing what's been done for thousands of years and making sure that the future generations know these things so that they can survive when civilization fails. Because I'm not afraid. Civilization failed, I'm going back to the bush. You guys can stay in the city. I don't care. You know what I mean? That's the importance, though, of culture for me. Because I'll always have something to fall back on.
Bridget, do you have anything to add to that in terms of bringing these sort of issues about environmentalism into urban spaces?
Yeah, I think it's a really good point and question around the sort of disconnection with the land and in urban spaces specifically. And I think it's been really important, I think, to reconnect with the land. I find especially in here, there are many ways that people are doing that I find really inspiring. And the way that communities will bring in, for example, like a sacred fire. So I remember like last weekend I was in Hamilton and it was the day for vigils for missing and murdered Indigenous women, and then people had brought in a fire. And so you felt all of a sudden like this reconnection to the earth from that fire, and the fact that people brought many of us there and shared those teachings. Because I think, yeah, like I think it was Taiki Alfred or it might have been Andrea Smith who talked about how at the root causes of violence against women and Indigenous women specifically and violence against the earth is this spirit of dominance, but also this disconnection with the life-giving force and with the land. And so I think when we reconnect with the land, it's like really, really powerful. But then I would also give a caveat for like settler folks of the problems of appropriation and like the importance of recognizing where these teachings come from.
Awesome, thank you very much. Do we have any more questions from the audience at this point? Yeah, Colin?
So you talked about a few things today, and responsibility was one that keeps coming up. And I'm wondering if you could answer as activists and artists, where, especially in a time where so much emphasis is put on the importance or necessity of youth to raise a voice, how do you engage with that as being a burden, as either a settler or First Nations, being kind of forced to speak to environmental issues, or how do you see that as something that is empowering? Or is it a little bit of both?
Someone, do you need a second to think about it? For sure.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it's about thinking about collectively, yeah, how can we use that to serve us as young people for our power? Because I do see it as, yeah, both being a burden but also a power. I remember someone from 350.org tweeted during the climate march that, you know, we're the first generation or one of the first generations to know about some of the impacts of climate change. So in that, there's like a power as well to be able to respond. But at the same time, in many different Indigenous cultures, for many, many years, there was already an awareness of a changing climate and the problems with industrialism. But I do think that as young people, there is like a tendency around revolutionary change. And if we look at movements like during the civil rights movement, at the forefront of that movement was young people who were doing the sit-ins to protest the racism that was happening. They were really at the front of that. And I think we're seeing that with movements today as well, like with Idle No More. A lot of the people who were organizing those dances were young people. With Occupy, a lot of people organizing were young people as well. And so I do think there's a real power. And I also think we have a power in terms of getting Harper out. You know, if we, I mean, and it goes beyond voting to direct action and everyday acts of resistance, but if young people were to vote at the same rate that seniors did in the last election, we would have a different government today. And so I think there is real power in that if we choose to use it. We have more power beyond just that.
Wouldn't, I guess, lean towards the burdensome aspect of the cause. For myself, I guess it's more of like the way my process works and the way the external issues kind of meld and come together is in that point between you know, what you've been taught and what you want to implement. And it's like the fruitful space where possibilities happen is in between those moments of what's been done and where we're heading. So like that really just inspires me to move and make art. And in that way, it's like, it is a very liberating to take our world as a whole and to know about climate change. And I remember being taught about it at a young age and not to deny it and to really step into being the, you know, the creators that are gonna push the world forth in a new space that it's currently you know, heading towards.
Well, I think this whole idea of responsibility, you know, like I said, it's both. It's a burden and it's awesome, because, you know, not everyone's going to agree what you're doing. You know what I mean? Some people will step all over you, you know, kick you while you're down. But I feel that, you know, the world needs to be enlightened. You know what I mean? It's too dark. More people need to start seeing the light. And not a lot of people want to. And so a lot of people will reject your ideology or your thinking and, you know, call you dumb or something. But that's the burden part of it. But to me, the good part is that, you know, there are people that listen. There are people that, you know, are open-minded. But not everyone in the world is open-minded, so it makes it a bit harder.
Awesome, thank you. Yeah, a lot of the conversations are really easy to dichotomize and try and put in boxes, but I think a lot of the experiences, as the day's events kind of shown, is there's a lot of intersections between these questions, and so it's important that we acknowledge that. We are moving, I think, into the last 15 minutes, almost. I do want to make sure we get a chance to ask the audience for questions. But before we do that, I was wondering if maybe we could just go through and hear about some of the work that you guys have going on now or that will be coming out soon. Kind of, you know, pump your stuff. It's like my Oprah moment. What's up? Like, so, yeah, so if you guys have, like, upcoming works, I'd love to hear about them.
Yeah, I'm really excited for upcoming exhibit through the YVR Foundation, and one of our panelists, Kelly, is also a part of that, and it's a really good kind of jump start into aspiring artists. So I've been working on pieces that are being shown in November, and it's going to be in the Richmond Art Gallery. And the main piece that we really worked on over the summer that was in conjunction with a billboard display was inspired from the Pilsner beer can label that had this scene depicting Canadiana life. It looked like 1920s or so. It has the railroad and all this, and it's a narrative, and it has the Indians off to the side by the teepee, you know, living, coexisting peacefully, and I wanted to bring that to light in our current situation of that story is still being told, and why is that? And I just made a piece in response to that sets it in contemporary terms, and that's about it.
Awesome, thank you, Emilio. Do you have anything?
Basically, I'm just in the writing process of a lot of things. I have like two short film ideas written down, and right now I'm actually in the writing process of trying to work on a demo of music. But over the past 2 years or so, I've been traveling and working for Wapakoni Mobile. I've been to the UN 3 times now, and they made a film the second time we went there, and also with Ray Kaplan. Ray Kaplan, that was on the video there too. We went to Finland together 2 winters ago. We made a film over there as well too, called Finding the Light. And for now, this past summer I was working in Montreal, and I was a filmmaker. I was working with filmmaker mentors, a very, very professional woman named Patricia Chica, and also Alexi Fortier-Gautier. And I've been keeping busy, but nothing yet to put out, nothing fresh, but within a year.
Yes, there's 3 major things upcoming in the works. One of them is a conference, which was an idea of an elder, and essentially, as you know, we're really facing a real onslaught by the government right now, especially having just rejected or having just approved the Site C dam, and now we have this real potential turning point for what the energy future of BC looks like, where the government is really promoting Site C dam, even though it goes against the wishes of many Indigenous communities, of farmers, of many people in BC. And then also LNG proposals, liquefied natural gas. They're proposing to increase fracking by 600%. And so one thing that this elder proposed is a women's conference, which would essentially bring together women land defenders and artists and creators to deal with the overlapping crises of violence against women, of missing and murdered Indigenous women. Especially, and to also grapple with the crisis of the attack on Mother Earth, and to have women from all over gather here, which I think will be amazing. And it's very much in its inception, but I wanted to invite people, if you're interested at all in receiving updates or helping to work on developing a plan for that, I'll pass along a sign-up sheet. And then the other thing is defeating Harper in the next election. We are organizing on campuses. We have actually a meeting next Thursday for organizing UBC students around defeating Harper. So if you're interested in that, please just put a check. And then the other thing is, ongoing solidarity in response to different communities who are blocking industrial projects on their land, like solidarity with the Klabona keepers who are just faced an injunction. So helping with organizing response rallies or petitions or different kind of support as needed.
Awesome, thank you. So we actually have enough time for a few more questions, if anybody in the audience had any at this moment. Okay, great. Then I will maybe just bring up one question, and it's not really a question, mostly a comment. Just thinking about, well, specifically on this panel, diversity in the films we watched, but also the diversity in the people on the stage right now and the type of work that they're doing that somehow still manages to fall under this topic of environmentalism and youth activism. Maybe do we see, for myself, diversity is it can be a really awesome thing, and it can also be a really scary thing, I think. What are your thoughts on that? Maybe not so much explicitly about the diversity of the work, but maybe even so. If you have any comments on that, I'm not sure. Maybe a little bit of a stretch. No, that, and you know what? That's fine. Maybe it was just not a great question. That's totally cool. I'll let it go. I'll let it go. It's great. So any other questions from the audience? No? All right. Well, then I guess I'll just wrap it up. I want to say thank you, first of all, to the organizers of the event, to the tech people in the back for being so awesome, to the people at home, live streaming, to our panelists. Yeah, thank you very much. Today was a lot of fun, and I'll hand it over to Rebecca.
And thank you again to all of the panelists. I wasn't expecting to come up right now. Okay. So thank you, Bridget, Emilio, Cody, and Matt, for that awesome discussion. Okay. Hold on a second here. Okay. So first of all, my hands go up to everybody that has made this conference possible. It is an extremely important event that was made possible by a lot of different people. Firstly, on behalf of the MOA staff, thank you to the moderators and panelists for your involvement and sharing your valuable knowledge. Also, thank you to the filmmakers who have allowed their films to be screened. All your work is very powerful and very meaningful, and I hope to continue to see what is out there and what is coming up. I would also like to thank the organizers, Jill Baird, Pilar Wong, Marion Roberts, Connie Lalo, sorry, who are the public program staff here at MOA. I would also like to thank Pam Brown, who is the curator of Claiming Space, your vision and fighting for having Aboriginal youth voice in the museum is extremely important, and we really value that work that you have done and that you continue to do. We would also like to thank the funding. This event was made possible through two Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council Insight Development Grants, Citizens of Tomorrow, Youth and New Media, and Youth Arts Practice as the production of knowledge for community development. I would also like to thank everybody for attending this event, everybody that's here and everybody that's live streaming. We wouldn't be able to have these discussions without you. And on that note, I was trying to think about what closing remarks could I give, but I think what is more important is just encouraging you guys to think about what this conference meant to you rather than me telling you what this conference meant. Where I come from, we're always told that when we attend an event, we're witnesses. We are not just people in the audience. And with that, think about what responsibility you guys have as being a witness to what has taken place here, being a witness to what these amazing Aboriginal youth have said, and thinking about what they are going to do and thinking about what we need to do alongside with them. I think that's very important rather than me telling you what to do. So with that, thank you all very much, and I hope you have a great evening. Gaila Kesla.